So we're going to learn tonight, page 112. It's a maimer from Parashas Va'eda, which discusses, we know that Moshe went before Paray, and Hashem told Moshe to show Paray the nest. The first thing he showed him to do was to take his matah, his stick, to throw it down, and it will turn into a nachash, into a snake. Afterwards, the Egyptians brought their kishif machers, and they did the same thing. And it says that Moshe, then the snake, Aaron's stick, was Aaron's stick that Moshe used. Aaron's stick swallowed up all the other.
Turned back into a stick, and the stick ate their snakes.
Right. So, what is the significance, the chlal of this? What is this?
Hungry stick.
We know there's a lot of different types of miracles. So why did Hashem chose this miracle? Why is this the miracle? There's a lot of miracles. Stick, snake, what's the significance? Furthermore, why is this the first nest that was shown to Paray? The first Mephis. Before anything else, the first thing Paray needs to see is this specific type. So everything has a reason. We don't think about it too much. Ah, he did a miracle, but the question is why this type of miracle? What is the significance of a stick? What is the significance of a snake? And why is this the first? So this is the Alter Rebbe, the Baal HaTanya, is going to explain to us a deeper look at this whole episode of the stick and the snake. The bottom of the second column, page 112, the bottom of the second column, by Yoimer Hashem Moshe Vel Aaron Lemer. Kach es matcho, take your stick, v'hashlich v'hem pari, throw it before pari, heal the sun and it will become a snake. Chulu, add all the psukim until v'yivla mate Aaron es matoisim, the stick of Aaron, swallow up their sticks. Says the Alter Rebbe, lohoven ingen hamate shenefach lanochosh, to understand the concept of the stick turning into a snake. In the parenthesis says, V'achagach, afterwards, what is the significance of Chazer V'nefach L'mateh? It went back, it reverted back to being a stick. V'gam, as well, we need to understand, Mashazel Yam Moifis Arishin Shenosin L'Pari. V'kodem L'chol Esamak, because this is the first Moifis they show Pari. And this is before all the ten Makis. To understand this, we need to have a little background. We need to understand some ideas over here of Kabbalah, of Pnimis HaTorah. Hine Ksi V'yinatzlus Mitzrayim. The Pasuk says, V'yinatzlus Mitzrayim. They emptied out Mitzrayim when they left. They took with them, it said they took with them jewelry and gold and silver. They said, do you have? They said they didn't have. We during the Makas Choshech, when they couldn't see, they didn't were able to see and see around what they had. So Amar Azal, Chazal say in Psochim, Shasua Mitzula Shem Adogim. The Yidden made, Bnei Yisrael made Mitzrayim into a net that has no fish. I mean, Mitzrayim was a place full of fish, a net, like compared to a net full of fish. But Bnei Yisrael left, they took all the fish with them. So the net was empty. They took everything out of Mitzrayim. So in a literal sense, it meant they took all the good things out of Mitzrayim, all the gold, the silver. But in a more spiritual sense, what did this mean? Pirush, in a deeper sense, shelokdu kol anitzutzin, shenaflu b'shvira aleihem. They gathered all the sparks of getlichkeit, of holiness, that were found in Mitzrayim, that were embedded in Mitzrayim, they took out with them when they left Mitzrayim.
By the goyim, this spark from the goyim or from the yidden?
What?
No, this
should. It's like this. There is a concept of shviras hakelim.
Right.
Before this world, or this world is called the olam hatikun. Before this world, there was a world called olam hatoyu, not a physical world, but a spiritual olam hatoyu. Toyu means chaos. It was a world of chaos, and Hashem made it this way, and there was the vessel, it says that there was too much light for the vessels to handle. Too much oil for the keli, and the kelim broke. The vessels broke. And they broke and they fell down into the world of Tikkun. And they're embedded in the world of Tikkun. And our job is, this is a Kabbalistic concept that Arizal explains, Avodas HaBeirurim. Our job is to refine the world and to bring back those sparks, uplift them and remove them from their where they fell down to. Now every area of the world has a certain amount of sparks. There are a total of 288 sparks that were dispersed around the world. And a lot of them fell in Mitzrayim. Most of them fell in Mitzrayim.
Did they fall just randomly?
No, obviously there was everything had a kavana. Mitzrayim got the most. That's why we were there for so many years. We were there for so many years because it took us a long time to uplift those sparks that were there. We needed to be there a while to do our job there. So it says when they left Mitzrayim, it says Vagam Ediv Rav Ol Itam. It means a multitude of nations came with them. I mean, a lot of other Egyptians and others, yeah, converts came to join Klal Yisrael. The deeper meaning is Ediv Rav. The word Rav means Reish Beis 202. Kabbalah, it says, there was 202 sparks that left with them, left Mitzrayim. 202 of the 288 sparks fell into Mitzrayim during the breaking, the Shviras HaKelim, the breaking of the Kelim, the vessels. It's a Kabbalistic concept. So in Mitzrayim, there's a lot of holy sparks, but they're sunken in into evil over there. It's an evil place. But deep down there, there's certain godliness there. For example, let's go back a few parashas. We know Yitzchak wanted very much to give the brachas to Esav. Ad kidei kach, in order for Yaakov to get the brachas, Rivka had to do this whole game, his own wife, in order to make sure that Yaakovina should get the brachas. What was the whole concept of why Yitzchak so much loved Esav? Why did he want Esav so much? So it wasn't just random, oh, Esav fed him good food, he was, you know, he liked it. That's not by our obvious. We can't take things like that on face value. Things are deeper. The reason Yitzchak saw Esav really has a great potential. He really, his source, the Shoirish, he has a very high source in godliness. But he fell very, very low. Yitzchak was hoping that with the brachas and everything, he will be able to uplift him and tap into that energy, that ruchnistic energy that was embedded in Esav. But Lamaisa, it wasn't the time for it. Esav wasn't ready yet to be refined. So that's why Yaakov had to take the brachas. So anyways, Pirush, what does it mean that they left Mitzrayim like a net without fish? What did the Gemara mean with that? They collected all the sparks that fell down in the Shvira. Mitzrayim was emptied out from these spiritual sparks in the Tzutzin. Until they were left like a net without fish. There was not even one spark of godliness left there. To understand this concept more, understand the kinds of the sparks that fell during the breaking of the vessels, the kelim. The ingin alasim and how they are uplifted. The idea is like this: at the ending of one of the parashas, maybe the ending of parashas Vayishlach, Vayeshev, we read about seven kings that passed away. And a deeper concept, these seven kings refer to the seven ancient kings of Toyu, the world of Toyu. What does it mean they're dying? That these seven kings died? It means there was a breaking of these seven levels of Toyu. Shenishbru v'nafulamata, the biya, b'chins klippas tacha. The light fell down into the realm of klippa and sitracha of evil. V'hainu k'mal derech mashal. The Alter Rebbe is now going to give an example. An example, what does it mean? Sparks of godliness fell down into this world, into a place of evil. What does that mean? So that sounds interesting. What does that mean? He's going to give an example. You have the neshama, we know, the neshama of a person before it came down here. It was standing before Hashem, and it was totally nullified in the light of Hashem. There was nothing there to hide, conceal godliness from the Neshama. The Neshama saw Hashem. It saw Ruchnius. So, therefore, the Neshama did whatever Hashem wanted. There was nothing hiding it. But when the neshama came down here into a body, which by the way the Zohar calls the body, the mishchad chibi, it's like a skin of a snake for the soul. The soul doesn't want, is not into the pleasures and indulging of this world. It's not what it's about. It's a spiritual entity. But it's stuck now into a jail. It comes down here. Now it's in a place where it cannot perceive and understand godliness like it did when it was like a malach in Shemayim. So now it does not see how everything, all the worlds really are created by Hashem. It doesn't see the reality. So the reality is concealed. So the same thing over here. The neshama, these sparks of holiness that fell down when the vessels of Toyu broke, came down into this world. They're very high sparks of holiness, like the neshama, sort of like. And it came down here into this world, into the realm, fell all the way down into evil. And our purpose is to work with the evil, to do Torah and mitzvahs, and uplift those sparks back to their source. Let's read inside, the last line of the page. And in Kamaya Derech Mashal, an example, Benishmas Adam, Neshama, a person, Shekoyin Neboy Lago, before it comes into the body, Hoyse Beteila Betachlis, top of the next page, Nun Zayin, Lagabay Nisar Baruch Hu. The Neshama was totally nullified before Hashem. When Shekos Uchai Hashem, Shemayat in the fun of. Hashem, I stood before you. I know Mishum Sha'oz, why was it bottled and nullified before Hashem? Nothing was concealing the revelation of godliness. So the neshama was basking in the light of Hashem. And so of course it was nullified before Hashem. Because it realized the truth. That's why it was nullified to its mocker, its source, totally. The kivan and since she yard the neshama came down here. When it slaps, it put on a clothing of the physical body. Azaya guf master la, then the body hides over it. Liyas nidma ha'oilam umilui liyesh v'davar nifer b'fnei atzmi. That the body conceals over the neshama, and now the neshama cannot see the reality anymore. The reality that once had in heaven is now no longer the same reality. The reality the neshama sees through the lens of the guf, through the guf, is that this world is a world, independent world. It doesn't see Hashem in the world, and it's an avoid that's to work on itself to realize Hashem in the world, because there's concealments here. There are even people that chas v'shalom could say, the world is here. It's always been here, and they don't realize the Yad Hashem. So that's all coming because the neshama is no longer lamayla. Now it has something concealing it. Fifth line, it doesn't see how all the worlds are really bottled, they're nullified, l'gabeir and sub for the infant one, which is giving life and creating all the worlds. So really this world doesn't have an independent existence. It comes from Hashem, but it can't see that anymore. So just like we understand this concept of the neshama being a holy being and falling down into this world, the same idea we can understand how these sparks of holiness of Toyu fell down into this world. The same concept. Kach adarech mashal hu ingin shviris hakelum, shenafla nitzutzin de Toyu, the sparks of the world of Toyu fell down, and islamshu beklipis de briye yitziyasiyah. They enclosed themselves in the klippa of the lower worlds. Shaklipis, the klippa has the power, machshichois ala nitzutzis, mastirim oisim ikol tzad, they darken and conceal from all sides that the sparks of holiness that once were up there close to Hashem, lo yargishu gilur and sab baruch hu, they don't realize anymore Hashem's light, to the point as sheyuchalis yesh davnei atzmi, they could start feeling they have an independent existence. Kemaimer, like it says, Phaaroh said, the Navi says, li yoiri, Phaaroh held that li yoiri vani tzini, I created the river, the Yor, the Nilus. Phaaroh convinced himself that he is the, and the Mitzvahim believed it. So it's very low. Things fell down such a state where such the opposite of the reality, that Phaaroh believes that he's the God. Rak, only one thing, the Kol El Kod El Kaya. The Gemara says that the Goyim, they understand that they can understand there's another Hashem, that there's Hashem above them. But they feel they also have authority and power. They don't realize that everything is Hashem. They call Hashem, he's a God. But he's the God of gods. We're also gods.
Middleman.
Yeah. Now, Ashakoidem Hashvira, before the even though before the breaking of the Kalim, Hoyanatsus the Talum Yichodim in Sabaku, all the sparks were all battle and one with Hashem. That was Mipnei Sha'oz there before the light was before it was broken. Hayim is Galin, Sabuham Gilu Yichagomer. The light of Hashem was revealed to them. So of course they were one with Hashem. They saw godliness clearly. And well, after the Kalim broke, and the sparks fell down into the klippa. They clothed them, they hide over the relation to God. It's just like we said before, how the body just like the body conceals from the neshama, this world, the klippa conceals over the mitzvah. Therefore, they're not any more nullified before Hashem than before, to the point you can have a pari. Someone like a pari? And that's exactly why they're called klippa. You know, in Kabbalah, evil is called klippa. What does klippa mean?
A shell.
Because it covers over and conceals the godliness. Just like the shell is a shell for the fruit or the nut which is inside. So you don't see the good. You don't see the fruit. You just see the shell. It's like a parable of a klippa appeal. It's like you have a nut in a peanut or in another nut, a shell. There's no other way to get the fruit out from it. You have to break the klippa. Just like there's no other way to get to the nut or the fruit without breaking through the peel. Kach, the same thing is, kedei lo hoitzi nitzutza ekdusha, to go now back, remove all those holy sparks, mehaklipis, hamastidim aleim, which are covering over them, hayitzarech liyish shvidis haklipis, you have to break the klippa, to remove the fruit. And that's the introduction, zeho ye'ingin ha'oisis ha'moisim makash and saying, kamani mitzashem. And this, the Alter Rebbe says, was the whole purpose of all the makis and all the special miracles that were shown before Pari. We're going to explain, it was all the purpose of breaking the klippa. In Mitzrayim, during the Shiras of Kalim, all these holy sparks fell down all around the world. And a lot of them fell down in Mitzrayim, more than other places in the world. And the job of Klal Yisrael is to get those sparks out. The only way to get the sparks out, they're in a klippa. They're in a shell around them. They're all covered over in this bubble. We have to pop the bubble and break the klippa. And that was the point of all the makis and all of these signs. And that was why, we're going to see soon, that is the significance of this first miracle of the stick and the snake. It was to explain this concept to Pare, what's about to happen here. There's going to be a breaking of the klippa. And we're going to explain that soon. What is this concept?
I have a question.
Miller used to be very famous in saying, take a banana, you peel it, so you see the godliness. Hashem made the fruit to be appealing for you with a shell. An orange, Hashem, to see the inside, the God created a banana, you peel, an orange, you peel, and then everything is formed. Purpose is a picture of godliness.
You said before that the Erev Rav was the klippa.
In a deeper sense,
When Moshe Rabbeinu went to Shemayim, what Hashem told him, Lech re ki shehet amecha. It's your people that sin.
We have to understand how does that work with the deeper meaning. That's pshat, the shayle or drush, how that fits with the soid ha-toyra, the deeper look. Okay, now, the next paragraph is a little more Kabbalah, but we'll read it through quickly, but the rest of it's easier to understand, but it's also not so difficult, but it's more Kabbalah language. We'll talk it outside a little bit. There is a concept in Bereishis, it says, that there was, about Gan Eden, it says there was a river leaving Eden. Eden had a river leaving it, which this river was watering the garden of Gan Eden, the Gan of Eden. Gan Eden is the Garden of Eden. It's not Eden itself. Eden itself was never revealed. People only go to Gan Eden. They don't go to Eden. Eden will be when Mashiach will come. People will be able to experience the concept of Eden itself. Now it says, there is a river coming out from Eden in order to give water to the garden.
Gihon.
There are now after it gives Gihon. After it gives the garden water, it says the river split into four other rivers. Rivers split off like all rivers do. They split off. There was four rivers. Split off into four rivers, and the Torah mentions the names of the rivers: Gihon, Pishon, Paras, Chidekel. Mentions all the names. It's not important for all the names over here, but now. One of them was Pishon. Pishon, it says the Nilus, the Nile River. What does this all mean? What is the deeper meaning of all this? Rivers, gardens, what does this all mean? What does this mean? The Torah, we're into rivers, gardens, what does this mean? Is Gan Eden somewhere in Africa? It's a Ruchni sticker concept. What does it mean? Just a little Nahar. The Nahar, Eden refers to the Ein Sof, the light of Hashem. Called over here it's talking about the high in Atzilus, there's four worlds. Atzilus, Bria, Yitzira, Asiya. Atzilus being the higher world. In the each world is made up of 10 spheres. The highest sphere of Atzilus is Chachma. So Chachma of Atzilus is Eden. Then you have the Nahar leaving Eden, the river leaving Eden, means it's a light of Hashem is being drawn down. The light from Eden is being drawn down through a river. River brings the water down, water from the place. Well, the light is coming down now through the river, and it's going to the Gan, to the garden. Garden is the lowest sphere of Atzilus, Malchus. All these details are not as important for the general Maimer, but I'm just going to talk about it. Now, the world of Atzilus, from the beginning of the world of Atzilus, from the first sphere, which is Chachma, to the last sphere, which is Malchus, it's all one with Hashem. It's called the Olam Ha'achtus, Olam Ha'achtut. It's all echad. Over there, it's still felt Hashem is one.
United.
It's all united. So there is the beginning of it is Eden, the ending of it is Gan, and there's a Nahar. The river is flowing from the Eden to give to water and to bring light of Hashem to the garden, to Malchus, the lowest level of Atzilus. But it's all still one river. Afterwards, the Pasuk says, after watering the garden, the river splits up into four. Now it's not longer one anymore. Now it's leaving the world of Atzilus, that high holy world.
So no achdut
afterwards. And now no achdut afterwards. Mm-hmm. And now it's spreading into four rivers. Now just like rivers down here, every river is different. There are longer rivers, wider rivers, shorter rivers. There are rivers that have different types of, the water tastes different. It's more salty, it's less salty. One is more clear, one is not clear. Different types of waters. Mm-hmm. Different types of nutrients. The same thing. These rivers, which are now have left the garden, they went past the garden, they're no longer united. These represent already klippa, certain levels of klippa. The rivers are different. They're not all the same. The water of Pishon is the Nilus, it says. It's the Nile River. The Nile River is one of the four. So it also receives from this river originally, but now already it's concealed, and the light is coming into the Nilus. The Nilus is Mitzrayim. Now, every river is different. The Nilus is a very, very big river. It is a very big river. If it knows about the Nilus, it's a very, very big river. Tremendously big river, physically. But spiritually, the Nilus received the most level of sparks.
I saw the Nilus.
Yeah, it's very wide, no? Tremendous. I read about it once. It's
one of the longest.
It's not the longest and the widest at the beginning. It's like tremendous.
So Lamaisa, it says, I mean, it doesn't mention that over here, but it just says over here, it talks about in the spiritual sense, that one of the four rivers, the river Pishon, which refers to the Nilus, the Nile River, received the most level of sparks of holiness, fell down into that river. Into Mitzrayim, that means. So the land of Mitzrayim received the most level of sparks that fell from the world of Toyu. And that was the job of Klal Yisrael, was to get them back. The only way how we bring them back and take them out of Mitzrayim is we can't get to the clip of the shell, the fruit, without breaking it. So you have to break the clip. And that's how we're going to explain how the clip is going to be broken through the Makkos. But that's what we're learning in this next short paragraph. We'll read it quickly. Hini Ksiv, it's written, V'nar yoitz me'eden, a river leaves from Eden, the Pasuk says. When we shall be apart after it goes to the garden, it splits up, V'hayu l'dalad rushim, to four parts. Shemech, a Pishon, the first one is called Pishon. Pirush, what does this mean? Nahar yoitz me'eden, a river leaving Eden. He means Hamshacha v'ha'ara, a drawing down of the light, and Himshech is coming from the Chachme Yilad Atzilus, the highest level of Atzilus, Shabbat, which in this highest level is enclosed, Melubish the Iron Saparcho, Hashem's light itself. Ubava Yada through Chachma, through this river, this Nimshech Iron Saparcho Bechal Atzilus, the river brings the light of Hashem through the all of Atzilus, to the point, to the lowest point of Atzilus, Nimshech Ab Bechinas Malchus Atzilus, which is called Hanikra Gan. Gan. Nezeo Lahashkis is a Gan. This is what it says in the Pasuk, to water the garden. It's watering it. It's watering it with the spirituality. Visham in the world of Atzilus, over there, Iuver Gamei Chabachoin, the Gzair says, over there, he and his vessels are one, meaning he is one with Atzilus. Atzilus is still a world of unity, where everyone realizes the unity of Hashem. L'chein hanar echot, shu'al inlach, that's why the world, the river is still only one river. Only one river flows to the garden. It's all one. But however, kivan shigil reish abriya, once it now left Atzilus, and it came to the next world of Bria, azai, from there on, mishom yipara, b'chinas pir v'schalkus, it divides up. L'dal nahar is the four general rivers. Shu'tchil sal, that's the beginning of division. Until then, everything's achdus. After Hashem, then on starts differentiations and differences that people don't realize everything. This is an example. Just like Naris rivers, one river is not similar to another river. Not in its essence. Some rivers are zisavaser, slulin, and they're clear. And the other one is not. Not only v'libegolim, not only they're not the same in their essence, but they're not the same in their size. Zenim Shech Masayim Parsois, Hashemim Shech Meyav Kaigam. The one is 200 parses long, another one is 100 parses, which is a measurement of the Chazal. Kach, the same thing, in the spiritual sense. In Doimin and Hodasim, the supernal, those rivers up there, are also not all the same. Zeloze. Daino Pishoin, Nilois Sar Shech Mitzrayim, Nilois Pishoin, which represents the minister of Mitzrayim, the Malach of Mitzrayim. In Babel, how many years were the Yidden in Golus and Babel? Between Bayis Rishon and Bayis Sheni?
70 years.
Yeah. 70 years. The Yidden were in Mitzrayim for a lot more, right? Because there's a lot more work to do over there. Babel also had Nitzutzes. But Paras, Nar Paras was Euphrates River. It's in Babel. By Iraq and that area over there. But the Nilus of Mitzrayim got a lot more than Bavel, much more than Tzitzis.
In the Torah, it's a Torah, Bavo, Vechoshech, Apenei Tehom. That's the Torah that they're talking about?
It's a hint to it. A hint, yeah. A hint to it. There is the physical meaning of it, that it was physical, but then there's always the deeper hints, what the Torah is telling us.
The inside, yeah.
Yeah. The Atah, from now, based on all this, Yuvan, we can now understand Inyan Hamoisim Sheherei Hashem Yisbarach Mitzrayim. Why Hashem showed all these miracles to Mitzrayim? Kamesha Kosev says in the Pasuk, why? What was the point of the miracles, the Makkos? V'yadu Mitzrayim Kini Hashem. Mitzrayim should know that I am Hashem. Hashem wants them to know I am Hashem. They don't know. Pari said to Moshe, I don't know. Le'yadaiti Hashem. I don't know who Hashem is. Mitzrayim does not realize who Hashem is. Hashem's letting them know. V'yadu Mitzrayim Hashem. How? Through these makas and these mifsim. Now over here is a deeper taich v'yadu. V'yadu means knowing, which we're using that over here too. But we're gonna. There's another psukim. The word yadu means breaking. There are psukim in Navi. The word yadu means breaking. Pirush v'yadu milashin shvira means breaking. And they broke them. The people of Sukkot broke them. So it has a meaning of break also. What does that mean? Why do we have to break? Like we said before, in order to get to the klippa,
you have to break it.
Break the shell. So v'yadu mitzrayim kin Hashem. V'yadu mitzrayim. In order for Mitzrayim to know Hashem, there has to be the interpretation of v'yadu to break Mitzrayim kin Hashem. Then they'll know Hashem is Hashem. But in the concept is like this. Kimavor Lomayak, we explained above. Shekadei lohoitzi and nitzutz min haklipa hamechasala. In order to remove the spark from the shell which is covering it, it's impossible. Ki im ayidei shviris haklipa mashalages. You have to break the shell just like you have in order to get to the nut. But ingin shayidei shviris haklipa yocholi is giler and sapar cholam nitzutz at sheyuchem lekus yisbarach. You'll break it, then the light of Hashem will shine once again, back again to this spark, which until now could not see the godliness. And once it sees it, it will come join back with Hashem. Yuchel b'lekosi. And this is a deeper concept. Over here doesn't explain it too much. The in sus v'reichir amayam. It says by Kriyas Yamsuf, the splitting of the sea, sus v'reichir amayam, the horse and its rider were thrown into the sea. Over here, he doesn't explain it too much, but he says, Pirush HaRoichev, the rider that's controlling the horse and holding on to it, not letting it move anywhere, is the klippa. HaRoichev HaMechasal, it represents the klippa, which is riding and covering the spark. V'zeu Yimah covers. That's what we read about Paray's chariot. This is a deeper meaning. V'yidei Shviyasim, through breaking the klippa, Nizgalo HaNitzutzis, the Ritzutzis are revealed. They once again reunite the Ein Sof part. And here in the parentheses, he actually answers an interesting question. You know, it says, through Kriyas Yamsuf, V'yod Mitzrayim Kin Hashem. They're going to know Hashem as Hashem. How are they going to know? No one was left alive after
Paray was.
According to certain opinions, Paray was. But where was the whole Mitzrayim? We're still saying, V'yod Mitzrayim Kin Hashem. Mitzrayim's gonna know, Egypt will know that I'm Hashem. But Egypt's gone already. They're not here anymore. No one there. So you won the battle, but they're not here anymore. So, but the deeper meaning is V'yadu comes from the word break. The Mitzrayim, the klippa of Mitzrayim will be broken and will know Hashem. The klippa of Mitzrayim will be broken. Now, then it sutzes, the sparks will rise up and they'll know Hashem. Come back to Hashem. In the parentheses, this will be answered what it says by Kriyas Yamsuf, V'yadu Mitzrayim Kin Hashem. L'chura Tamua, it's a wonder. We say later on the Pasuk that none of them survived. Ella, rather, it must be the deeper meaning of V'yadu, not just knowing, because there's no one here to know. V'yadu also means, like we said before, breaking. Pirush V'yadu Lashin Shvira. Through breaking the klippa, the sparks saw. The heim yadu yidiman v'itaken knew that Hashem ani Hashem. After the klippa was broken, Mitzrayim was broken as a klippa, the sparks now were able to come out from being their concealment, and they now taken know Hashem. Mm-hmm. Through the breaking, the two pirushim come together. Through the v'yadu, which means breaking, there will taka be a v'yadu of knowing that Hashem is Hashem. Because they're going to come break the klippa, and then they'll taka know Hashem is Hashem. Until now they didn't. Because in another place, I explained this question also. Now, alderas are the same thing over here. In ha'eser makas, the concept of the ten makas, is b'day l'shaber ha'klippis lo'hitzin sozun. To break the klippa, take out the sparks. It's not for the Yidden, it's not for Klal Yisrael. Klal Yisrael did not need the miracles. Yisrael atzma lo hayu tzrichin l'maisin klal. Kei ma'minim b'nei ma'minim. They were believers and sons of believers. K'mesh akas, we see right away Moshe Aaron came and spoke to them. V'yom en am, v'yishmu kipakad Hashem. They believed Hashem is going to save them. Rak, what was the point of all these makis and all these miracles? Yisrael lo hayu tzrichin etzutzes hamuvloyim teich haklippis mamash. For these whole, to remove the holy sparks in Yitzutzim that were embedded and swallowed up within the klippa. Hutzachlius Eser Makas. Now that's why they needed to be 10 Makas. They either knew there was Hashem. They didn't need to watch Hashem doing the spectacular fireworks of all the 10 Makas. They knew Hashem's Hashem. Mm-hmm. This was from Mitzrayim. This was when they accomplished something in Mitzrayim. Shezel B'shuvi Yod Mitzrayim. This is to create a breaking of Mitzrayim down, breaking down the klippa, that they should know this Hashem. And now that we have this whole introduction, we can go back to our original question. Now understand, what is the significance of the stick becoming a snake, and why was this the first Moifes? Well, b'zeh yuban inyan ha-Moifes ha-Rishon, shehera Hashem yisbarach l'pari. Shu ingin, it's just this paragraph, this is the ending of the Maimon. Shenefach ha-nat l'nachosh, the stick turned into a snake. Shezeu ha-kdam l'hol-asnech. This was dafke, this miracle was now, because this is the beginning, an introduction for all the Makkas. Pare is getting an introduction now to what's going to happen. When you write a book, there's an introduction. There's a little introduction here to all the Makkas. We're going to let you know what's the plan over here. Kiine ingene esa Makkas. We explained before what's a 10 Makkas. Shalusha baraklippis. Lishbaraklippis. Shalukhinis yesh v'darv ne'atzmi. The klippis feel that they're independent of Hashem. They don't realize their source. Mishakaz, like I said, Li Ori, Pare felt that he's a god. Rak the Karl of the Kai, and Hashem is the God of gods. We didn't realize Hashem is the ultimate God and there's no one else. The Ingen HaMois, and the idea of the miracles was Lahari Islam to show them a She'im HaYois when it's Klippa and Sitra Achra Mamash. Even though they are Klippa and Sitra Achra, Afa became, still in all, you should know where your source is. You think that you have your own source. You have your own existence. You're independent of Hashem. You should. We're going to show you the point of the Makkas is, and that Maisim, show them that you, your source is in Hashem. You don't have any power besides for Hashem. Afa became still know that you're a klippa. Every single second you're getting your sustenance from Hashem. Without it, you would cease to exist. It's not like they're false thinking that they're an independent existence. Rather, what are they? They're in reality, they're really nullified before Hashem. Only they don't feel it. Why? The light of Hashem, their sustenance, their chayis came down to them through so many coverings, concealments. All these contractments and these concealments concealed over Hashem's life force that's giving them life to live and exist as a klippa, to the point that they don't anymore realize that they have that Hashem is their source. To the point he says, Li Yairi, I created the river, Pari says. L'chein, therefore, Behigli Sa'ara Rabba, when the concealments will be removed, a great light will be shown on them, and they'll see the truth. The whole thing will become, the whole bluff will be called. Their bluff will be called. Higlis ha'ora rabba shalomayim etzumtzum. There will be a great light shown on them above all these concealments. They betalim and mavatolim. They become batul mavatul. Nothing. Mizeh ha'yin ha'yin. That was the idea of the ma'yfisim. All these signs. Valzeh ha'yin ma'yra ha'yifis ha'rishim ma'at ha'nachal nachash. That's why the first one, miracle was a stick turning into a snake. Pirush. Mata olosham shachav ha'toy. The word mata comes from the word Netia, Noita. Over here, the way he explains it, it's being drawing down. The stick shows how Hashem's godliness comes down on like a stick. It coming down, being drawn down into the world. Chain Shevet, also the word Shevet, another way of saying a mata stick is Shevet in the Torah. Gam Kilash Hamshacha also means Hamshacha. Kamei Koichwa the Shavet. It was a certain star.
Koshavet.
In English, I don't know how you say it, but it has a like a
spark,
going like flame like coming out.
A comet. Has a tail and back.
Yeah. So it's drawn. It's coming out from something. The stick represents and a kol hamshacha seder shtal shel kedusha mireish kol dagen and tzeif kol dagen nikra mata. The stick, the mat, represents the symbolism of all the holy levels of godliness coming down in a descending manner. V'tan, what does a snake represent? That's the source of all klippa, the snake. Yimikara klippis the Mitzrayim. The source of the klippa Mitzrayim was a snake. Actually, the first one was also the snake, the Nachash HaKadmoni.
Yeah.
By Adam, right? Doesn't mention here. K'may shakasav atanim agodol Haroi v'sateichi oirav. The pasuk says there's this great snake in the Nilus. What's this great snake? What was the great snake? That represents klippa. Snake is not something we love. It's something from the klippa.
So why was the kappa snake the symbol of the
fool? Very good question. Very good shayla. The herele Moshe v'Aaron, Moshe showed, was showing Phaaroh, Moshe and Aaron, how the stick turned into a snake. You think that you're here on your own. You snake, Phaaroh, you think you're here on your own. We're telling you, no. You know where you come from? The stick. You come from Hashem. You come from godliness. The stick turned into a snake. That's how you came around. You didn't come here by yourself. We're going to show you. We're demonstrating a demonstration to you. We're going to give you a little shear over here. The stick is how you came about with the snake. You really also come from Chalikos, and you're not independent, you're not a god, and you have no power. Your real source is from the stick, just you don't realize it. It's concealed. But that's really where you come from. It says the feet of Malchus, of Atzilus, the feet go down and give life force to the klippa in the world. So the klippa gets its source from Kedusha, just as concealed. Hashem's kingdom is everywhere. Everything comes back to Hashem's Malchus, to Hashem. Ella, rather they don't see it. It's Sumim Rabim. Like we said before, this is through many Tzimtzumim of concealments, like the light, when the light wants to come into the room. And we put on a curtain, so you dim the light. Another curtain, you dim it more. So the light is getting dimmer and dimmer. So they don't, or you put a, let's say, a light through a glass. You have a glass, a discolored glass, or a different, a green, a red. The light is really pure, but when it comes on the other side of the glass, it's a different color. It's light, but it's a different color. So the light is, well, everything's coming from Kedusha, but it's concealed and it's being changed. So when they look at it, they feel like, oh, they don't realize the truth. Actually, to the point, it was so concealed, the Ayur of Hashem, Nefach v'matanach, the stick, Elikos turned into a snake. Became a snake. Shaydeitz and Sumerabim Elu Mistater Hashefa Mibichnis Amata Kol Kach Hachayuchelis is Havos Bichinas Hatanim Hagodoris Techereva Emily Yerdi. To the point that it was so concealed that it could bring about a Paray who thinks that he's a god. To such an extent was there a concealment. There's different levels of concealment. But it went so much down, the Chayis, the life of Hashem, to the point that he already feels he doesn't see anything at all, and he thinks he's it. Now, so that was the first step. Pyre was being shown, you should know you really come from the mata, the stick, you come from Elikos, godliness. Now, what happened? After Moshe and Aaron showed him, the snake became back into a stick. Not only did the snake turn back into a stick, but the stick of Aaron swallowed up their sticks. What is that significance of that move? They were showing to Phaaroh that just like you came originally from Elikos, from the stick, and now you're a snake, you could also reverted back into the stick. That's what's going to happen over here. You're going to go back to realizing that you're a stick. You came from the stick, and you're going to, from the Likos, now you're a snake, but the snake is going to go back to being a mata. Go back to realizing its source, and that it has no independent existence. The great snake is going to become nullified for Kedusha, like it originally was. That is the way how we uplift the sparks that are in Mitzrayim. It says in Pasuk, Ata Kel Mestater. Hashem is a God of concealments. Hashem conceals himself. Every day we see tzaris and problems and we see evil in the world. He's a God of concealments. He concealed himself. If we would see him clearly, there'd be nothing to discuss. And Matan Torah, the whole world shook. And the Yidden, the Neshamas left them. It was, you saw Likos. If you see a likus, there's nothing doing. You see godliness. But Hashem conceals himself. Ata kel mistater. You know, he hides himself like a father playing hide and seek with his children. The father hides himself and wants the children to find him. So Hashem is playing hide and seek. He's here. He's hiding. We have to find him. That's our job. Whenever Hashem wants, the snake, he allows the snake to feel like it's a snake, Pari, for a while. But now came the ending of Mitzrayim. Now it's time for Pari to realize, game's up, and Hashem is Hashem, and whenever Hashem wants, the snake will just turn right back into the stick, and it will all be a likus again. And that was the point, not only the first one, that was the point of all the makas. After each makas, it says, every makas clearly says in the Torah, you look in the Pesukim, you'll follow through, now we're going to start reading the makas. Every makas was there, they should know Hashem as Hashem. This is the way how they're knowing Hashem as Hashem. And that's why the first one was showing what's going to be. The first thing, Pari, the first statement, they're meeting Pari the first time, they're telling him what's going to be. There's going to be a plan here. We're letting you know this is who you really are. And this is what you're going to be. You're going to turn back. You really come from the stick, and you're going to turn back into the stick. And that's what's going to be the whole process.
Why the Torah?
A beautiful mimer from the Alter Rebbe, the Balatanya.
Why the Torah called the Nachash Tanin? Tanin, it's inside the water. Nachash is outside the water.
I don't know. Usually we don't translate Tanin like the snake. I'm not sure.
No, but Tanin is... we know what Tanin. Leviathan is Tanin. It's a big fish.
I'm not sure. I'm not sure why he's connecting. Tanin also means this tanin with a nun, with a mem. I don't know. It's a good question. We have to look into this a little more. But I remember once learning this, it always struck me a very short and nice idea. The whole. This is the kind of Yodim Tzayin Hashem. That was the sparks that they took up when the Gam Erev Rav Oli Tom. It was the Eid of Rav, they came up with the Reish Beis, the Rav, the 202 sparks that they took out from Mitzrayim. Then they went to Bavel and took out the sparks of Bavel. By the way, one time, the Rebbe, just on a side note, the Rebbe one time by Fabringen spoke of this concept about, you know, how Hashem wants us to search for him. Like the father playing hide and seek, he wants the son to search for him. So Hashem hides himself and he makes it challenging and we have to go find Hashem. You have to learn and dive in and make it difficult. So the Rebbe one time cried and said, what happens if the son gets tired of finding hide and seek? He forgets that it's a hide and seek game. What happens if the son starts to forget that his father's hiding? So he said, Hashem, you have to come out already, reveal yourself, because your children are forgetting that it's all here for a purpose, and we are all here to supposed to seek you. But they're starting to forget to seek you anymore. So they forgot there's the whole purpose here. So we're losing in touch with the whole process here. Hashem, you have to, your perspective. The Rebbe was crying that, you know, we always say, Hashiveinu Alecha Hashem and Ashuva. So the Medrash says, the Yid and Yisrael battle with Hashem. Who should be the first to come back? We say, should be... Hashiveinu Alecha Hashem and Ashuva. You come, Hashiveinu Hashem Alecha. You come back to us, them and Ashuva. Hashem says, you first come to me.
And then we have this argument with Hashem.
So we have to work on both lines. You know, we have to come back to Hashem the whole time. We have to do our part, but we also have to still beg Hashem. Don't wait around, you know. Don't wait. Come back to us already. Amen, and it's about time.
It's about time, yeah.
Time for the Gola. May we see the Gola of Amen.
Amen. Amen. You know, there was, I don't know where it's calling from, but... I don't know where it's calling from, but in from Gola to Geula, it says, why is the redemption taking so long? There was only 86 sparks, and yet here we are, more than 3,000 years for the 86. It says they fell into the different worlds, and then they split and split and split into tiny little pieces of sparks. And they're all spread out over the rest of the world.
I can tell you one thing we see in the world. Do we have a minion, by the way?
Yeah.
What?
Yeah.
Someone's coming?
Yeah.
Oh, Moshe's coming. Okay, good. There's one thing I'll tell you that. Well, get ready for Maidav. Oh, wait. It says in the Torah there's four impure animals. The Torah gives examples, a lot more animals that are treif. But the Torah says the Torah only mentions four of them. The Torah mentions the neves, the rabbit, and the chazer, and the camel. It mentions four. Chazal tell us these four represent the four golosim, the four exiles that Klal Yisrael went to. Mitzrayim, Bavel, Edoim, and all the golosim. It says that golos Yavon, the Greeks, when we had the time of Hanukkah, all the four times that we had these golos represent these four animals in the Torah. Each referred to animal. However, there is in Tehillim, it says that David HaMelech asks Hashem, Luli Hashem Shehoi Lanu B'kumalein Adam. If Hashem, if you were not with us when Adam stood up against us. So the deeper meaning of Adam is that after the four behemoths, the four golosim that are compared to behemoths, there's going to be Kum Aleinu Adam. There's going to be a nation which is referred to as Adam is going to come upon us. Before, after all the four exiles were complete, we finished with them. There's going to be one more golos. And he's not compared to a behemoth, he's compared to an Adam. And who is called in the Torah an Adam?
Yishmael.
The Malach told Hagar, Yishmael is going to be a para Adam, a wild man. He's referred to an Adam. So we find that everyone else, Mitzrayim, Bavel, Yavon, Edom, are all referred to in the Torah compared to a behemoth. The only one that's called an Adam is Yishmael. So after the four Golosim, there's going to be a period of time where there's going to be Kum Aleinu Adam, where Adam, Yishmael, the Muslims are going to come against us, Yishmaelim. And it says in the Arizal, Son writes this and others, that there's going to be this period of time. And you might see today where for the entire world, we don't suffer that much anymore from the Christians, which all the generations, we only suffer from the Christians, not from the Muslims. The Muslim world was much better for us. I'm not saying they were tzaddikim, but they are much better than the Nasrim, and we always suffered in the hands of the church and the Galachim, until the culmination was World War II, where that was the last thing from Galus Edom. Afterwards, all the nations of the world became welcoming, the Klal Yisrael, to the point we actually had a year or two ago, that their Avi Avos, their main guy in Italy, stood up and said that after 2,000 years of persecuting Jewish people because Am Yisrael killed their God, he decided we're absolved from any sins and it's not nothing to do with us anymore. He said it's all over. He stood up and said this. So you understand, if anyone thinks a little bit, the spiritual significance of this is unbelievable. For 2,000 years, they're murdering Jewish people around the world because we did this to their God. One day they stood up and said, it's over. This was the official announcement that the Klippa, their minister up there, whether the guy down here knew, he Mustafa doesn't know anything, but up there was moving him right and left. And their Tsar, the minister, said, it's over with this Golos. But unfortunately now we're having the Golos of Yishmael. And everyone realizes, so anyone who has an eye to see, sees an entire world, wherever they are, they're blowing things up. Every single country, they themselves are fighting each other, and they're it's like the last 10 years, 5-10 years, nothing in history, never heard of such a thing. The Muslims are blowing themselves up around the world and making wars and wherever you are in the whole world, and they're fighting with who? With Edom. They're busy fighting with Edom, and they're fighting with Klal Yisrael. So this is the last thing. So let's hope it goes b'shalom, and we get out of this galus quick.
Amen.
Unfortunately, the...